What's up, fam? Welcome to Birds of a Feather live on A2D Radio. We are in our own Real Talk studios. We got a collection of guys again tonight. We're going to be talking running backs, but we're brought to you by our sponsors. First of all, Dr. Paul Vidal, the best in the business, specialized physical therapy. You can check him out, Burlington, Cherry Hill, Princeton, New Jersey, or find him on the web, specializedphysicaltherapy.com. No appointment necessary. So check in with the doc and hit them up. Or as well, Ambuck Services. You need gutter cleaning, gutter guards, tree trimming, deck insulation restoration, outside work. You hit them up. It's ambuckservices.com. Let them know that the fam here at A2D sent you, and you get 20% off, guys. You got to get those houses cleaned up. It's coming to that time of year. And hey, we might be opening up soon. You might be hosting some people. You want to look at your best. So definitely hit up inboxservices.com. Our topic of conversation is brought to you by QB54, the best tailgating game in the business. And if you use the promo code NONOTES, you get 10% off. You can find it at playqb54.com. And that is that, and correct me if I'm wrong, Chucks, Christian McCaffrey is the best running back in football. Agree, disagree?
Yeah, you got it right.
Look at that. I only looked at the criteria one time. How about that? And reminder, too, guys, before we get into our conversation, we got to give a shout-out to PhillyDrinkers.com. They are our official apparel. You know, they take care of our official apparel. Tons of things. I think it was 42 or 43 A2D items. If you check them out, PhillyDrinkers.com, including the awesome Quarterback Factory t-shirt that you see right here on your screen. And for that shirt, if you use the promo code A2D, you get 25% off that shirt. Don't want to make anybody think it's going to be the whole purchase. It's not that. It's specifically that shirt. It's a great shirt. It's freaking fire. You can find show shirts. You can find the fix. You can find AM in the PM, agree to disagree, Birds of a Feather, Lazy Booking, and all of our shirts across the board. So, guys, we're back. We're doing our draft night here. This is night three of our draft. You know, for week one, we did quarterbacks. Last week, we did wide receivers slash tight ends, where, of course, our buddy over there in Fiji decided he was only going to be the only one to draft a tight end. I wish I was where you got to put some sunscreen on, buddy. You're getting a little bit burnt over there.
I was supposed to put it on about 20 minutes ago, but the interns, unfortunately, are out having their good old time, so nobody was here to assist.
Well, I imagine you don't put it on yourself. You have the interns rub you down. So,
well, exactly. I'm not getting, you know, these hands all messed up. You know.
Hold on. No, did you see that man walk on water earlier?
That's true. We had him walking on water. But yeah, so part three of our draft series, we're hitting running backs. This is going to be a hot conversation, and we know we got a lot of running back guys here. And I know on this program alone, we've had some very hot moments and heavy moments when we talk about running backs, particularly two gentlemen up here have had quite a few battles when it comes to running backs. I actually got it right this time. I remembered it was the opposite side. You think
it's not mirrored.
So, you know, we're going to talk running backs. Do we have the draft order that we can pull up here?
Yes, sir. One second.
So just a reminder, with the A2D draft series, we are all drafting our own teams. And then at the end of this, we want to know who has drafted the best team. And it's on paper, obviously. But we want you guys to vote. We want you guys to give your feedback. Every week we drop kind of the progression of where we're at. So, I mean, I know I have a GOAT team at this point. Sorry, fellas.
Whatever.
Yeah, but did yours get you to Fiji? That's no, I'm kidding.
Who are you sharing that room with? Jimmy G?
Sharing Jimmy G going Dutch.
Sharing the room, sharing the bed.
They're not practicing the social distancing. Hey,
not at all.
So let's pull up the draft order for tonight.
So we have Tom with the number one overall pick, Pete with the number two pick, Chucks with the number three. I have the number four pick. Mr. Fiji, Kevin Godwin, has the number five pick. And Mr. Chrome has the final pick in the first round, the sixth pick overall.
Yeah, and you guys will be able to keep track of it. We're going to have all of the draft picks scrolling across on the bottom line here. Julio says he didn't see the poll question. The poll question is, Christian McCaffrey is the best running back in the NFL today. Agree, disagree. So, Tom, you're officially on the clock, Dad, with the first overall pick.
Well, listen, so
just like last week, sorry I got you off, but whatever your answer is, tie that into the poll question so we can.
Absolutely. I was planning on it, but you know, this has been a week of thinking. So we knew about this draft order a little earlier than we've known about other ones. And it's been tough. It's been tough because it's between two guys. It's between Christian McCaffrey and Saquon Barkley. And I love Saquon Barkley. I do. I truly do. But to tie it into the poll question, I agree he's the best back in football. Because I was trying to think earlier, they both do a lot of things similar, all right, in terms they both can catch the ball well, all right? Now, what's the difference maker? One, McCaffrey, to me, catches the ball more out of the backfield and better, right? And their running games aren't that far apart. Saquon's more of a power guy. I get that. But in terms of, like, yards out of the backfield, it's not like there's a big separator where Saquon's that much better out of the backfield running the football than Christian is. So that's where I was trying to, like, tie it in. Like, what's the tiebreaker here? And honestly, he does both things better. He does both things better. And I can't believe I'm saying it because I don't think many people thought he'd be that good out of the backfield as a running back out of Stanford. We knew he was electric. We knew there was big plays out of the backfield. But he's really turned himself into a great runner out of the backfield. And we already know what he can do receiving the football. So to me, I agree with the poll question. Christian McCaffrey, hands down, is the best running back in football. Because to me, in 2020 NFL, it's not what you just do at running the football. It's your ability to catch the football out of the backfield too, which is so important. Not a shot at Saquon. He's great at that. I think it hurts him in this poll question, missing games last year, okay? If he plays a full 16 last year, I'm probably taking him. But it hurts him. It hurts him. And I am building for the future, and I would love to have him on my team. But listen, the way my quarterbacks are built and my wide receivers are built, with Russell Wilson leading the charge here, man, I got to have Christian McCaffrey out of the backfield. With the number one pick of the running backs, I'm taking Christian McCaffrey to build my running back foundation here. Chuckster, thanks for the number one pick. I deserved it. I was picking 5 and 6 too much here.
Get credit. Like last week, I do not get credit. That's all Fantasy Pros, draft order, random generator, whatever. So you got the sixth pick last week. Now you got repaid by them with the first. So good job.
Yeah, just the way I'm built, guys. You know, I'm built with Russell Wilson being able to extend a lot of plays. You know, I think that – and then my backup, Kyler Murray, does the same stuff. So, you know, I'm built with both guys being able to extend. I think having a great receiving back just helps that out even more. And I don't agree with people that don't think he has a long shelf life. I don't agree with people that think he's not a worker. I don't agree with people that think he gets paid and he's going to check out. Listen, man, it's about pedigree in this league. Look at Daddy. Daddy ain't going to let that man check out, okay? You want to talk about guy checking out, talk about Zeke, right? Talk about Todd Gurley. You want to talk about checkout cities. You ain't going to talk about checkouts when Coach Christian McCaffrey. He showed up every game last year for a terrible football team and was their only sign of life and their only pulse offensively all last year.
For me, it's really close between the two. I would never argue against Christian McCaffrey and, you know, and say anyone's wrong for picking Christian McCaffrey. I personally would go Saquon by like the slimmest of hairs. Like I'm talking about like this little hair here, like that slim. And you, what you were saying, like it's absolutely right. Like right now as a runner, when you factor in like vision and everything, Christian McCaffrey definitely has better vision. What he's been able to do since he got drafted, adding on the weight and becoming a better runner inside the tackles is phenomenal. And I give him so much credit for that. And then as a receiver, I don't think there's a running back that's better than him. The only thing I would say to the reason why I go Saquon is because Saquon just athletically is more gifted than any person in the league at running back. Like he is like the next coming of Barry Sanders, but just like bigger. And you know, when it comes to Saquon, he can do things that I've never seen someone do since Barry Sanders. And in terms of being a receiver, I think that's more of, it's not so much Saquon, but it's more of how the Giants didn't use him and how like Pat Shurmur like just was not creative enough in getting him involved as a receiver in the ways that Christian McCaffrey has been used in Carolina. I think that if Saquon had a better offensive coordinator or head coach that would use them better, you know, Sean Payton or anything like that, who was more creative, he would have similar receiving numbers. They just don't use him the right way. So I think that it's just – it goes to the fact that I think Saquon can do things with the ball in his hands as a running as a runner that no one else in the league can. But, like, there is one thing that he's getting better at, but he still needs to work on is his vision. And I think that's what CMC trumps him at, as he's a refined runner out of the backfield with his vision. So I'm not going to argue against CMC. I personally would go disagree, though, and go with Saquon personally. But I honestly think it's very, very, very close.
See, I favor Christian McCaffrey just because, you know, they're both very good. You know, you can lump Ezekiel Elliott, at least in my opinion, in this group to where it's kind of like a big three. To where, for me, it's Christian McCaffrey way over. Now, I don't want to say way over Saquon, but I'm confident in saying Christian McCaffrey over him just because you look at the injuries. You know, obviously, you enter year two with Saquon Barkley, and you had that extensive injury. Christian McCaffrey's never missed a game. He's played 16, 16, 16. He's gone boom, boom, boom. And so I think that's really impressive, not only given what they've asked him to do in the backfield, but also as a receiver, also special teams. The fact that he was kind of the premier offensive player when they didn't have Cam Newton, or even sometimes when they did have Cam Newton in Carolina. So I completely disagree with anybody saying, oh, now that he's paid, he's going to completely take a back seat, he's going to deteriorate. I don't buy that for a second, because he never showed any signs of deterioration before here. So I'm only going to go after what I see. And like we've talked about before, in a way, yeah, I could say that he's the best running back, but I think he's a top five, maybe, you know, borderline top five, definitely a top 10 player in the NFL. Because he does so many things very, very well. And I think when you talk about him aging, you know, as he goes on throughout his career, okay, to take out some of the load, we've talked about it before, okay, then he could do more in the slot receiver role. And there's no question that he's able to do it, because he's done it at a very high level on top of doing things in the running back position. So to me, I absolutely think Christian McCaffrey is the best.
Well, you said, I agree. Player. Real quick, sorry, Kev. You know, I mean, he might be one of the best receivers in football, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, that's the whole separator here. That his shelf life's going to be a long one because he can do so many things.
Yeah, I mean, I agree with both you guys, Tom and Ryan, as far as, you know, just his ability on the field goes. You know, I've been very open in saying that I think he should have been last year's MVP. You know, 1,000 yards receiving, 1,000 yards, you know, rushing out the backfield. Yeah, it's pretty much bar none. You know, no one else out there is doing that at the level he is. I mean, there's a couple of people that may have better hands, you know, coming out the backfield, but not putting it together, you know, with the running side of things. And the really, to me, the unsung part that separates him from anybody is the hard work and dedication he's put off the field. You know, coming out his rookie year, he was not that size. I don't see, you know, to me, that's something you can't teach. You can't coach that, right? I could teach you a little bit about the vision. I could teach you how to find holes on the line. I could teach you how to, you know, hang on to the ball in the backfield. But I can't teach you how to go home and, you know, put on 50, 60 pounds of muscle to be able to outperform other guys at the position where you may lack in God-given talent like Saquon has over him. So to me, that puts him, you know, head and shoulders above everyone, because I guarantee if this race was even a little bit closer, if you put, you know, Saquon in a different offense where, you know, outside of Pat Shermer, where they are using him a little bit more, McCaffrey works that much harder to keep his number one spot, where I don't know if Saquon does, just because I haven't really seen it yet.
Yeah, I just want people to know.
I love Taylor's comment, by the way. Who's going to have the hot take today? I can't wait. I can't wait.
I mean, everything's been hot down here so far in Fiji, so I'm waiting for my water.
This guy is something else.
It's been 90 and humid.
Julio for me said it best. I appreciate Chuck. I'm gonna tip my cat. Pretty much introducing my pick. And when I think about the poll question, Christian McCaffrey is more of a complete offensive weapon than Saquon. But if I just take it, their running back traits and just athleticism and being that home run ability with a trash old line, I got to take Saquon over Christian McCaffrey. If I'm solely looking at their running back position. He's a couple years younger as well. I'm sitting here looking at his stats right now. Only played in 13 games, and still had over 1,000 yards and still had almost 500 yards receiving as well. Christian McCaffrey had 4 receiving touchdowns. Saquon, the 3 less games, had 2. So I understand. But once again, I think we saw a comment as well. If you put Saquon in Carolina's offense, I think the numbers are similar, if not somewhat better. Not taking anything away from Christian McCaffrey. As Tom said, we knew about this with this draft order days ago, almost a full week. So it was tough because we kind of knew who was going 1-2. We just didn't know the order they were going in. So, I mean, pretty much everything has been said about Saquon and Christian McCaffrey. Both great players. I think Saquon, athletically, is probably a generational player. And then Christian McCaffrey really surprised me with his durability to this point so far. I will say this. I don't know how hard Christian McCaffrey would hold up if he played in AFC North, but that's not something that's just semantics. We don't know. He plays in NFC South. And I think he benefits from down there being in a warmer climate. Most games playing indoors and also in Atlanta, New Orleans. So it's not really there for him to take that tax on his body. And trust me, he played in California. He played for Stanford. He played in the Pac-12. So it was. I think it's his pass to the NFL, and the miss that he debunked so far. He deserved to get paid, and if he falls, he falls. But I mean, just taking a foot race, I'm taking Saquon over Christian McCaffrey every day of the week. That's just me.
Well, hold on. Who'd you think you were going to get tonight? That's the question I have for you. Who'd you think was going
to get? I was cool. I've never been so happy to get a sloppy seconds. I've never been so happy in my life. It was easy. Okay, whoever he doesn't take, I'll take.
Who'd you think I was going with?
I thought you wanted to go Saquon.
You know what? And it's funny because that's why I wanted you to say that, because I think I was there. You know, I think not that he's the best running back in football, because I think that's McCaffrey. I still agree with that poll. But I was there because of how much of a freak he is, like Chuck was saying. And like you were saying, it's hard to run away from that. I mean, you talk about a high ankle sprain. Dude, you should be out 10 games. You should be out 10
yeah.
games. Yeah. Right, 10 games. You played 13. What? What happened? What I meant? So, like, that's what was so hard about it. And yeah. I love the kid because he's such a good kid, too. They both are.
I can't beat him.
It's so hard. I just separated the receiving. Like, I just said, okay, what's the big separator? The guy finds the end zone more somehow.
Right.
Finds the end zone more. And they both are like that big play guy out of the backfield. So it's not like Saquon's that explosive 70-yard to the house guy and McCaffrey isn't. You know what I mean? They're different bodies. They're different styles. But they both can take anything to the house at any moment.
Yeah.
Listen, I almost would rather have had number 2 tonight because it would have been easier than number 1.
Yeah. I mean, listen, Saquon against the Eagles, he threw up the deuces.
Yeah.
In that game, after having a high ankle sprain. Like, come on, man. Like, he was.
That's crazy.
So, yeah, I mean, yeah. I don't. I didn't envy your position today, Tom. I really did.
Me either.
Yeah. To me, like, to what Brodo was saying, I know Brodo earlier was saying, like, it's like in the one tier, it's them two and then Zeke. I honestly, I all respect to Zeke, but I don't put Zeke on that tier with them. And I'm really trying to be, I'm being as objective as I can be, but when you talk about all around skill set, and I'm talking about like a person, when I look at the running back position, and you guys all know, I say this all the time. I put so much priority in a running back's receiving skills. And I'm not saying that Zeke has horrible hands, but as a receiver, he doesn't do this kind of stuff that Saquon and Christian McCaffrey do. And so I put, like, it's almost like if I'm doing tiers, I'd put Saquon and CMC as, like, generational talents, and then I'd put Zeke as, like, the elite tier. You get what I'm saying? Mm. It's not that I don't see Zeke as elite. It's more of, like, Saquon and CMC are just above him because they're hardly any flaws to their game. That's what I'd say. If people want to disagree and say, like, I'm hating because he's a Cowboy, you can go ahead and say that. But I've said it, like, for years. I'm consistent. I say it every week with a lot of my takes. I'm consistent. Like, I'm not out here throwing out around, like, hot garbage takes. So
with that being said, you having a third pick, and let's be honest, Zeke, I mean, you can have Christian McCaffrey or Saquon behind that Dallas offensive line who –
I might
go with 2,000 yards rushing. They get 2,000 yards rushing if they had that offensive line.
You see what I'm saying? You know what I mean? But with that being said, the third pick, If you're going where I think you're going, and you're talking about receivers, and you're talking about elite talent,
I'm in the
pool.
Are you?
Are you talking? I'm in the pool. Are you talking NFC North here?
So this is really tough for me because like I had a few guys to choose from. Like when I'm looking at the names, you got like Dalvin Cook, you've got Alvin Kamara, you could even talk like Joe Mixon. Am I right? Like Joe Mixon, someone who is in a horrible, horrible situation in Bengals, and he doesn't get any love. But I had it when it came down to it, I had to choose between Dalvin and Kamara. I part of me still doesn't know who I'm gonna pick. Like I really see like
tough one. Tough one.
You can't spell Dalvin without Alvin. So I mean,
that's true. What makes me worried? And let me get your opinion on this, guys. What makes me worried is if we were talking about this last year, Kamara would absolutely be my pick. What kind of worried me is with Ingram gone, his production kind of plummeted a little bit. You get what I'm saying? Like, and when I would consistently watch him, it's like, is it more so him that is not able to carry a full workload, or is it just situation that bad offense? So like, that's what's tough. And that's in my back of my head is like, can Kamara be that focal point of the offense?
He wasn't Tennessee.
That's a great question, Chuck. Hold on. That's a great question, Chucks. And I'd be happy to answer that question after you make your pick, because I'm not influencing your pick in case I want one of those guys and they drop.
I'm keeping my mouth shut.
So why
I'm
don't you make
my
your,
mouth shut?
Why don't you make your pick and then maybe we'll have a conversation after those guys are off the board?
Chuck, all I'm going to tell you is
I mean, if you're in the war room draft nighter,
I know
you're in the war room draft nighter. Are you calling Buffalo to ask them what their opinion is on a running back? Probably not.
No, I'm not. I just try to talk this out because I've been going back and forth, and I really don't know which. Tom, what were you going to say?
My bad. Sorry, I wasn't trying to talk over Comfort there. But come on, you know, if you remember Alvin in college, I mean, he was a focal point guy. He has the ability to be a focal point guy. The size is always going to be a concern with durability. I don't know if he's a guy who could take that whole workload. I don't know, to your point. You know, Dalvin's always been a workload guy, though. That's all my point. Like, even though he's been hurt, he's been banged up, he's always been a workload guy. So, I don't know. This is a tough one.
It's so tough.
Chucks,
it's so tough.
Because we are working with a clock system here.
Make your pick. Make your pick.
Don't be the freaking Browns or the Bengals. Don't forget to call it in. Don't forget to call in the pick.
You know what? Kevin, is it hot? How hot is it over there?
It's pretty warm.
Well, not as hot as it is right here. I'm going this way.
Oh, my God.
I told you. We knew it.
Put it in ink.
We knew it.
Put it in ink.
Throw out the bait.
We're taking bets. Chucks, the best part about it, Chucks, is the whole time you were talking, you were side betting on – is he going to take Miles here? Is he going to take Miles here?
I thought he was going to wait until the second round at least.
Yes, Tom, yes.
Yes, you guys know me so well. And I'm not even going to front. It's a reach, but I don't care.
We called it a half hour.
I literally texted him. I said, this guy's taking Sanders.
I was going to go on air, and I was going to be like, okay, I have to decide between Cook and Kamara. But if last second, if I can't decide between them two, then I'm just going to go with Miles. So that's what I did. For my boy.
Tom, where did Tom go?
He jumped in the pool. He had to cool off.
Oh, where is he?
Dude.
I took my side.
We literally had a side. We had a side conversation.
No, I want to know.
We intentionally didn't add you in because we knew that you were going to take Miles in this part.
I literally,
I'm not mad at you.
No, but did anyone bet that I wouldn't? I want to know that.
No.
No.
No, I texted them.
It was unanimous.
Yeah, Chucks, I texted them. I said, any predictions on what crazy running back selection Chucks will take tonight? And then I said, I will jump through the screen. I said, Miles Sanders at number 3 is a legit possibility. This is all before the show. Yes. And then 2 minutes ago, he said, 2 minutes ago, I said, this guy is going to friggin' take Miles Sanders.
Kevin,
I'm not running from it. I did. But I'm going to take my guy. I'm just going to do it. Because if I'm taking the lead guy, if I want a back to be my primary back in round one, I'm going to take Miles. So, I did really consider the other guys. I really did.
We know you considered it. I love you. I love Miles. The track record as a whole isn't there like the other guys. So what I'm witnessing right now is an all Philly team happening. And I know what your agenda is. You want the votes at the end. You know the market we're in. You know the market we're in. Oh, the only thing I can do is go drown myself now because I lost. There's no way.
Yes!
I am so happy I got Tom to jump in the pool. That was totally worth it.
It's like Baywatch. He's coming. He's running.
Oh my God.
Just making sure he gets out safely.
That was totally worth it.
Oh God, the room's spinning.
But just to make this clear, I do not rank Miles Sanders as the third best running back in the league. I don't. He's not third. I don't care.
Is he doing laps?
He might have to do several laps.
Does anyone see him as he surfaced?
Did he drown?
Oh my God.
I don't know.
I'm worried. Where are you, Dad?
Oh no! Oh, there he is.
There he is.
Someone hit the Baywatch theme. Somebody hit the Baywatch theme.
I'll be ready.
Oh, that's true, Gavin. Chuck's his next pick, Boston Scott. See, I thought I was going to go Elijah Holyfield here.
Wow. See, I knew he wasn't getting past Chuck twice. I knew he wasn't. I'm just shocked he took him in the first round.
Boys, I'm going to do everybody a favor here. I'm going to make mine as simple as possible because I'm not even going to try and follow that up. Pete, get the pen and paper. Just give me Ezekiel Elliott and I'll go to bed. He's reliable. He doesn't get hurt. Sure, he'll have some couple missteps and I can't stand him, but he's a very, very good running back. I'll take him and go to bed.
Oh, great.
I'm about to say you feel
Hey. That was amazing.
Thank you, Chuck.
That was totally worth it. Just to get Tom to jump in the pool, that was totally worth it.
That was, and I don't even mind the pick that much. I didn't. Oh, I might have. Good time for a cool off because before things got too heated on here. Cool down. Cool the body.
And that's the thing. I'm not even running from it. It was a reach. It was a total reach. But hey, I'm having fun and I'm gonna take my son. So we're not betting money on this or anything. Yeah. So I'm gonna take my guy. And again, I don't rank the third best back in the league. I just wanted to have a little fun here.
Here's what I'll say about it, Chucks. It's a reach. Obviously, we knew it was going to happen. But if he takes that next step this year, now being officially named the workhorse, it could be something that we go back and say, even though we got time to jump in the pool on that, it could be something that we can go back and say, maybe you were onto something. Maybe you got the steal of the draft. I'll say that.
Yeah, no, I mean, if he continues on the path we think he can continue on, there's zero wrong with the pick. Well, in a small sample size, there's zero wrong with the pick too. Explosive, catch ball in the backfield, can do everything. You know what I mean? Can do everything. I mean, it was put on a tee for you. So when you started talking Cook and Kamara, I didn't think there was any shot you were going there. So you threw us all curveball there.
I did. I was considering them too because I was trying to talk myself into one of them so I didn't have to go Miles. But at the end, I'm just like, F it. Let's have some fun. So
Hey, Kev, your turn to jump in the water now, buddy.
Or walk on it.
I mean, with my team, I probably could. But up to my pick. So I was also torn. I wasn't torn as much as Chuck's on his picks here. Everybody knows I'm not really the running back guy. You know, hence why I decided to just go on vacation and let you guys argue up there.
This freaking guy, man.
Are you a QB guy though?
He's just a Jimmy G guy. Did he freeze?
Oh God, Fiji! No. Did he fall? Oh God,
Fiji took him.
Did he fall in the water?
He's gone.
both catch.
Is he doing the mannequin challenge?
He made his pick too.
He's gone. There he is. There he is.
Oh my God.
Oh.
He said, "Oh."
Everybody disappeared there for a second. I was wondering what was happening. Hey, you're back, buddy.
We didn't hear anything you said at that point. So
okay. So I was split here, right? I need a guy that can kind of do both, like a Christian McCaffrey-esque back. He's the best in the position to do this. But the next best guy, in my opinion, is Dalvin Cook. So
Good pick, Kev.
Yeah, nobody can argue with you, Kev.
You guys. I ain't mad at that pick, Kev, and I'm really happy because you guys left me my two backs that I really, really wanted for my my swing around. But I ain't mad at you at that, brother. If you didn't take him, or if you would have taken my first pick here, I would have taken him. For me, number six, I'm going to go Alvin Kamara. I think he has a bounce back year this year. I think he's as close to a Christian McCaffrey as you can find, maybe slightly a tier under. But I'm looking for that guy who can catch the football out of the backfield and can be explosive. And then on my wraparound pick of the second round, I want that guy who's going to beat the shit out of everybody and pound the football. I'm going Derrick Henry.
Ooh. That's a good combo right there.
Listen, you're in a great spot right there. So you got a little thunder lightning combination talk. I love it. That's two great picks right there. Two great picks.
Yeah, I mean, I love the Kamara pick. Obviously, that was my toss-up. If you hadn't taken him on the swing around, that was going to be my pick. But what people forget is when you have a guy like Michael Thomas down in New Orleans and a young tight end in Cook, you know, that's where I think you've seen the numbers decrease on Kamara just because he hasn't had to do anything. You know, he hasn't had to carry a team because, you know, everyone else around him is developing. So they've kind of watered out a little bit. Not saying that the talent hasn't diminished or he can't put up numbers like he did 2 years ago. So, you know, that's a great pick right there.
Well, look, back to my question.
I think he has a bounce back here this year.
Yeah, like what for the rest of you guys, do you think Kamara's decrease in production? Because if you look at the stats, it actually, you know, I think we remember all of this. Miles actually finished with, what was it, a little, like, in stat-wise, if you look at the main stat you know, running back stats, his numbers were better than Kamara's, which is surprising. And we know how good Kamara is. Do you guys feel like Kamara losing Ingram was a big reason why that production went down? And he's not the type of back that can really be the focal point of an offense like, you know, the other upper tier guys? Or do you think it was just like one of those one off, like down years that you can write off as, you know, just an anomaly?
Not for me.
I think it was just a down year.
No, so not for me, to be honest. I just don't think Kamara isn't – I don't think he's a bell cow back in this league. He needs something else. He needs a bruiser with him. Just because the toll on his body, he did get a little banged up. He missed two games last year. And also, it's just – as a defense, you get smarter. You can just get used to this change of pace, and you don't have that. But if you take a look at New Orleans, even when they won the Super Bowl that 1 year back in 2010, I believe, they had kind of a two-headed running back scheme. So that's what made them successful. And, I mean, Mark Ingram, low-key, was probably one of the biggest losses to them, and they tried to replace him with Latavius Murray. That didn't work. I don't even know if they went running back this year in the draft. I really can't tell you who they got there. I mean, I would have loved for New Orleans, probably to trade for or sign a Todd Gurley. So you have Gurley and Kamara there, two backs that can spell each other. I think that would have been dangerous. But just to answer your question on your own, Kamara, he has something to prove to me. So I'm not in the down year side of that pool. I'm in more of, if he has to do this by himself, this is what we're going to see. We're going to see 700-800 yards rushing, maybe 500 yards receiving. We're not going to see that boom like we did, because that's also to be told that that year that they did do that, when Mark Ingram was there, that offense was clicking on all cylinders. So, I mean, it was just maybe more. Maybe it was the O-line that last year just didn't execute as well. We really don't know. There's so many different parts that play into this that goes into a running back success, like you talked about with the vision. So I'm just not sure if it's a down year for him. He has some more proving to do to me.
Yeah, see, I think it is a down year. I just think his talent, there's too much talent there. I think they ran the offense a little bit differently last year. You saw Michael Thomas get a lot of looks last year. For me personally, I would suspect a bounce back year this year. But we'll see. Ralphie.
Ralphie
hating on you there, Chuck.
I replied to him.
But you know what?
Yes!
That back?
Oh, my gosh.
You know what, Pete? To your point, though, in terms of what, you know, the nature of what we're doing here, I would feel more comfortable if he had a more of a grinded out, pounded out, north and south running back, which is why, in terms of the exercise we're doing, I look at him and his diversity and his skill set, and then I pair it with a bruiser like Derrick Henry, who can just run guys over. And to me, that makes more of a dynamic backfield. So I would agree with you in that sense that I'd feel a lot better with him in actuality if he did have that more of a reliable, consistent bruising back.
Quinton does make a good point here that Breeze was hurt for a good period of time, so that might have been a factor too. I don't know to what extent.
How, but, though? Because Bridgewater went 5-0. I mean, what did the team miss when Breeze went?
The result was, it's not about the result. It's about Kamara's production. You know what I mean? Okay. Like when you have Bridgewater, it's going to be more conservative. Like, you know, he can't do as much as Breeze, like, obviously. So
yeah, but to play devil's advocate, usually that means a slimmed down offense, which means more check down reads. So you would assume actually that Kamara's production would have gone up because you're gonna have less looks than a veteran guy like Breeze.
Maybe,
or unless you take that all together.
Yeah, maybe. I don't know what I never charted like the stats in terms of like how many passes were thrown to check downs and everything, and how many targets Kamara got when he was playing with Breeze as opposed to Bridgewater. I'd have to check. But you know, who knows? Like it could be one of those things where they also threw more to Michael Thomas. We know how many catches Michael Thomas had. Maybe they went more wide receiver with Michael Thomas and, you know, tight end. I don't know. I'm not saying definitely one way or the other. I was just throwing it out there as maybe as a possibility, you know?
Okay.
Yeah, I just think in this league, it for some guys, it takes time to be the main guy, you know? So it's a big – it's a lot on a guy's shoulders when you come in the league. It's you and Ingram. It's a different situation. Now you become the main guy. You're the focal point. Now teams are game planning even more for you. And then the loss of your quarterback, I think it all could be a little bit of combo on a semi-down year. I still think he has the ability to be the main guy, but I always think they're going to need some thunder behind him. That's all.
Mm-hmm. Cool.
So
Kev, you're on the clock, buddy.
You're up.
So okay. Okay. So I'm going to ride Ryan, right there.
Ryan, were you going to say something?
You're frozen, Crumb. I can't hear you.
You said, were you going to say something?
Oh, no. I'll wait. Go ahead, Kev.
Yeah, so I'm going to ride right on Chrome's coattails there and go in the same direction. A guy that, you know, for me, you know, I look at three things: his age, availability, and dependability, right? Can you be on the football field? So there's a young cat out there, played all 16 games, two seasons in a row, and behind Derrick Henry, who just went, he was the second among running backs as far as yards, and can do a little bit of out of the backfield catching to alleviate some of the passes to Cook. So Nick Chubb is my take there in the second round.
Good pick.
Kevin, you can't go to
Fusion. I like it, buddy.
You actually make sense now.
Chuck knows this. There has not been a bigger Nick Chubb and Ryan. There's not been a bigger Nick Chubb fan in the world who's not a Cleveland fan than myself since before he was drafted. I almost took him over Derrick Henry, but I love that pick, man. I think it's a great pick, and I think that he's going to be a force for that Cleveland team for a long, long time.
Yeah, I think it also plays well in my team's favor, having a Michael Thomas and a Diggs that stretches the field vertically to where it changes it up to where he's at now with a younger quarterback, to where it's not, pound the rock as hard, being a lead back. So I don't have to worry too much about the availability on his knees like you would with an older guy in Gurley who does something similar up the gut. So, it bodes well for him, to say the least.
Do you guys want to do a quick round one recap? Just because people were asking, like, is this guy picked? Is this guy picked?
Yeah.
So for thank you, Frank.
So let's remind the fam too, real quick. All the picks are scrolling across the bottom.
Mm-hmm.
So if throughout you miss track or you lose track of any picks, there's three rounds. All of the rounds are scrolling across the bottom and who picked who.
And also, fam, keep in mind, too, it's not just for 1 year. It's about building your organization. Who would you want to draft if you put them all back in a redraft and build your organization for the future? So we're factoring all of that in.
Yes.
So Tom took Christian McCaffrey, number one overall. Pete went with Saquon, number two. Chucks went with his boy, his son, Miles Sanders, of number three. I went with Ezekiel Elliott, and Tom, number four.
And Tom got wet.
Yeah, Tom got wet in the pool. Kevin went with Dalvin Cook at number five. And then Chrome finished off round one with Alvin Kamara at number six. And then kicked off the second round with Derrick Henry. And then Kevin just picked Nick Chubb. So I believe it's me, correct? It's me?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. I'm going to go with a kid. I'm going to go a little bit younger. He was in the running, obviously, for offensive rookie of the year last year. He reminds me a lot of you can say this is high praise, but he reminds me a lot of him because he's almost a smaller version of him because he breaks a ton of tackles. I think he's going to end up being a specimen in this league. I think he has a very long future. And he was really dealing with a mess of the quarterback position, and he kind of still is. But I trust him because I think I can get 10 solid years out of him. Okay. And what he already showed me is I'm very impressed. I'm going to go with Josh Jacobs here. Sorry, Tom.
Beast.
Hey, like Chucks, is it fair for me to call him like a mini Saquon? Because like I look at him and he breaks a tackle here, Is it possible to get him on the ground?
I know what angle you're taking in terms of what calling him that, and you're not incorrect, because if you remember the year that Miles was drafted, he wasn't my top ranked running back. It was Josh Jacobs. Josh Jacobs was my RB1. Sanders was my RB2. I just felt like Sanders had a higher potential he could reach, but with Jacobs, you have a guy who's one of the toughest runners I personally evaluated in a draft for a running back. He is tough. Like, he runs angry, but he is not just power. He's finesse too. So he has a very good build. And Josh Jacobs, like, there's a reason why John Gruden loved him and was so adamant about getting him for the Raiders, because he has that multidimensional skill set and he's a great receiver. So he has he's an all-around guy. He's physical. He's quick. He's fast. So I wouldn't say like he's in the talent level of being a specimen like Saquon, but in terms of like what do I say, like, one of the biggest traits in terms of elite running backs, how they separate themselves from average guys is forcing missed tackles and creating on their own. And that's something that Josh Jacobs does do very well. He's very, very good at making defenders miss or breaking tackles and then creating for himself when there's nothing there. So I get what you're saying.
Gotcha.
All right. Oh, I'm up.
I know exactly what you're doing. I know you too well.
Do you know me too well? I did mention this guy earlier, and I'm kind of happy that he fell to me here. It's no hot take here. It's not a hot take here because I, like I said, I mentioned him. I think I'm going to go with Joe Mixon, who is, to me, again, stuck in Cincinnati with a horrible team. He is so, so good. He's got an all-around skill set. And every time I look at him and I watch him and study him, he just impresses me so much. And it makes me so mad because I can see his career playing out like AJ Green, where he's just wasted in Cincinnati, not doing anything. And a guy that no one talks about because the Bengals are bad. Hopefully Burrow being there might turn things around, but I've always been a fan of Mixon. I feel like he is an underrated guy that doesn't get talked about enough. So I'm really, really glad that I can kind of make up for my super reach with Miles at three and go with Joe Mixon here.
I stand corrected, Jux. I don't know you as well as I think I do. But you're going somewhere else.
No, you know me well because you knew I was going to pick Miles.
All right, I'm one for two. I'm one for two.
There you go.
Still got a third round there, Brodo.
Yes. Yes, true.
And we have a name in mind that we think might go to Chucks in the third round.
Yes.
No, I like that pick, Chucks. I agree with you. I like Joe Mixon a lot. Yeah. I do. I like Joe Mixon a lot, and I agree. I think a lot of any kind of shortcomings for this, the most part, have been because he's stuck in Cincinnati, man. You put him on a much better competitive team with a good offensive line, sky's the limit for him.
Yeah.
I mean, that was my toss-up on my pick. It was either Mixon or Chubb. To me, it went size and just, you know, a little bit more proof in the pudding. You know, I know that he's on a team that, you know, doesn't really have much offense in general. But having seen a little bit in Chubb, I know what I'm getting a little bit more versus having a prove it type guy in Mixon, where you haven't seen him climb too much up the potential tree to, you know, just because it's being wasted, as you said, but overall still a good pick there.
Yeah. What to do, what to do, what to do. We talk about future, right? That's what we're talking about.
Building forward. Yeah.
Sure.
So pretty much I've taken a young pup every time. I've taken a young pup as a quarterback. I've taken a young pup as a wide receiver. I'm going to take one now. And I like his situation a lot. I think he's going to the team with the best O-line of football. Definitely the best probably overall tackle guard of football. He just likes the moss people. So I'm, if you could run behind Quentin Nelson – I'm feeling. So I'm going to go Jonathan Taylor here.
All righty.
That's a good pick, Pete. That's a good pick.
Quentin's upset because we don't – he's like, Melvin Gordon, Leonard Fournette? Don't worry. We have another round here. We have time. We have time.
So I go back to
no,
back.
At this point, no, not yet.
Yes, Tom, I think you go back to back here. Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
Man, this is tough. This is tough. I love there's guys on the board that I like a lot. I mean, I'm not going to give away any names because everybody knows the names. I mean, I love Melvin Gordon. I love what Melvin Gordon can do. It's a name that's been like staring at me throughout me just sitting here watching you guys pick. There's a name that I figured would still be here. But guess what? The fact that I want to go a little bit younger. In that position, I'm going to take Sony Michel.
Ooh.
Wow.
Wow.
Ooh, okay.
I'm going to take Sony Michel. I need some power with the Christian McCaffrey. I want to have a power back with him, somebody that has that ability. I like Sony Michel a lot. I think he's an underrated guy in this league. I think he has been. You know, even though he was drafted high, it's just nobody talks about him. Not talked about a lot. But to me, very productive. Not great. Not great. Which is a really good back, and I think he's going to be a good back for a long time.
Yeah, I mean, okay. I agree with you there, Tom, and I also think that he's been a victim of running.
Of course you do, well, Kevin.
But see, the thing that he didn't bring up is that he's been a victim of a running back by committee. They had Brandon Bolden last year. They had, you know, all the different weapons that they have out of the backfield. They throw tight ends back there now. It's just been a mess back there, and I think it's going to continue to be a mess in New England's backfield, unfortunately. So, you know, I know my boy Sonny would like to be up there with Tom. You know, I wish I could bring him down here to Fiji, but there's just not enough room.
So now this next one on the back-to-back game becomes a little more interesting because I want to stay young at the position, and it's between two young puppies, both going to be rookies.
Yep.
And we already know the two. We already know two. But guess what? I know everybody else might think a certain guy is better than the other guy. But I ain't buying that game yet. So it is Mr. Swift for me, DeAndre Swift, I'm taking with this pick. I like, listen, the little Clyde Edwards, Hilaire, I like him a lot. I do. Swift's been doing this for a minute. I'm taking Swift.
Okay.
Hilaire just came on the scene. Let's be real there. Nobody was talking about him. He's good. He's good. But now, you know, people are making him out to be a little bit more than he is on an explosive offense. I'm not saying he's not special. I'm not saying he's not a human little joystick. But remember, I don't remember having this conversation last year as much about him as Swift's always been on everybody's radar. And explosiveness, they're similar even though one's bigger. You know what I mean? Explosiveness, being able to catch the ball out of the backfield. They both do well. And at the backfield, I think they both need a little bit of work running the football. But most rookies do coming into the league. Nobody's going to be perfect coming in, especially when you're taking a rookie. And Jonathan Taylor, obviously, better out of the backfield than these two right now, more proven at coming out of college. But again, does he have the hands these two have? So to go along with sort of my theme here, listen, I love the kid. I wanted him in the second round. You know, I wanted to trade up and go get him. But Don in Detroit got him, and I think he's a perfect fit for the Detroit Lions with Kerryon Johnson. I love that combo, and he's gonna be great on this squad as well with Christian McCaffrey, Sony Michel, DeAndre Swift. I think we're built for the future over here.
You're not wrong, Tom, because, you know, this is someone who had Clyde as, you know, RB1 and then Swift as RB2. I completely get what you're saying. Like, Clyde didn't come onto the scene until this past season. And, you know, he was playing behind people, and he was a special teamer, and then he had to step in, and then he burst onto the scene out of nowhere. So you're not wrong. And, you know, me having Clyde RB1 over Swift was – I never meant that as a knock. You know, anyone like, you know, I know Clay is a big Clay Ferguson, our A2D fan. He was a big, huge guy. He's a huge Georgia guy. And, you know, I would talk about, you know, Swift all the time with him. And, you know, with Swift, it was never a knock on Swift. I've loved Swift since day one, too. Swift is all around, hardly any weaknesses. And, you know, it doesn't hurt for him being a Philly guy, too, right? But no, I love that situation. And honestly, I do think he's better than Kerryon Johnson. I think he's going to take that job by midseason. Not only like Kerryon has durability issues, but Swift is just to me a better talent than Kerryon. I was never a huge Kerryon guy, but with Swift there, a good 1-2 punch. But I give me Swift over Kerryon all day in Detroit. I think they're going to ride both of them a lot, and Swift is going to have a pretty good rookie year.
Yeah. And listen, you're not wrong. Like 1A, 1B, it wasn't easy. I want to be clear about that. That wasn't easy. I could have went Melvin Gordon there, but like we've been talking about, everybody watching, everybody paying attention to this A2D draft series on Birds of a Feather, is that we're building teams for the future here. So we have to think long term. You know, Melvin Gordon, to me, better than Sony Michel, right? I mean, it's not an argument, but a little more tread on the tires than Sony. So I'll take the chance there, right? I probably should have went Melvin Gordon over DeAndre Swift too. But the way we're looking at this and building this, and the same thing Pete did with Jonathan Taylor, and Chuck's essentially did with Miles in a way, is take these young guys that we see a big future with, and hopefully, and somebody did it with Chubb. I mean, everybody's been doing it. So it's fun. But Mark Ingram's on the board. Melvin Gordon's on the board. I get it. But to me, they're not built franchise around guys right now in their careers. That's all.
Yeah.
So real quick, I'm going to do a round two recap just for everyone just joining us. So with the seventh overall pick, Chrome went with Derrick Henry. Kev, you were the Nick Chubb pick, right?
Yes.
Okay. Then I went with Josh Jacobs at 9, Joe Mixon with Chucks at number 10, Jonathan Taylor with Mr. Pete Evans at number 11, and Tom closing out the second round with Sony Michel. And then so far we have DeAndre Swift, 13th overall.
I want to ask you guys that because we didn't really talk about Sony at all, and I heard a lot of oohs, right, and ahs. So I want to know. I want to know everybody's thoughts on it because we really didn't dissect it much. And I know what Kevin is. I know Kevin had my back. I mean, we're both by a pool. Well, he's by an ocean.
Yeah.
I'm at a pool. Not the same. But still more color. At the end of the day, I want to know your guys' opinion on the kid because, again, he is a running back by committee guy. He is stuck in Bill Belichick's rotating system. But I really believe if he had the opportunity Chubb had, right, in Cleveland, I think he's having success like that. Too. Like, I think he's a guy who can take a 22 carry workload a game. I think he's built for it. I just don't think he's really gotten that full opportunity. But I just want you guys your thoughts on that one.
Go ahead, Carl. Go ahead, Carl.
I don't hate it. I don't know if I would reach that. To me, it's a reach. But in terms of what we're building here, in terms of the exercise, I don't hate it. I could see why he would. I like Sony Michel, and I understand what Kevin's saying in terms of being a guy who's in a rotation right now when he could possibly be a workhorse. I just am not confident enough to know that in another situation he would be, more productive. And that's kind of where I'm at. I'm like in a weird impasse with him, which is why I definitely, especially a second round pick. I know with you being – the first overall, and you have that wraparound in the third, you're going to have to reach basically for guys if you're trying to build it the proper way the exercise is.
Right.
I don't have the confidence in Sony Michel that he would be that guy to take the workload elsewhere. The talent is there, you would think, but I don't know. I don't know if I've seen enough to convince me that I definitely believe he could be that guy if he wasn't in that situation in New England.
Yeah, for me, I really, really like Sony Michel. It was just I don't know. It's tough because the only reason why I would say it's a reach there, it's because actually no, because I'm wrong, because that was your last you already made three picks, so it's not like you could have waited until later, correct?
Yeah. Right.
Okay, so I was gonna say if you had like the 15th, 16th, or 17th pick, I feel like you could have gotten them. But given where you were at, it makes sense. It makes sense for fit with what you're trying to do. I would say the one kind of concern is that he was kind of banged up a little bit last year. He kind of hit that sophomore slump, which isn't, again, it's not unheard of. You see it all throughout the league with all different positions, especially after year one where he really jumped off the page. He really impressed. There were those rumors, which I don't know how much validity there was to where, Bill Belichick kind of lost faith in Sony Michel a little bit last year. But just based off of talent, what he was able to show so early in New England, I think with what you're trying to do with your team, I think I'm absolutely fine with it. I don't think it's idiotic by any means.
it's not Jimmy Garoppolo in the third round or second round.
No, that's correct.
Now or don't find him at all. You know what I mean? Or might not be able to get a young power back. That's the sort of position I was in. It was either take him now and get somebody that can complement McCaffrey that way, or sort of get stuck with an older guy. Or not even get stuck with an older guy because I didn't have any more picks yet.
I've liked Michel when he got, the year he got drafted. He was high up on my board, and people were like up in arms about Bill Belichick taking him in the first round. I was completely fine with it because I knew the direction they were trying to go. When it comes to running backs in New England, and Kevin knows this, it's so weird. I'd never take a Patriots running back. Because Bill, week to week, will have a different guy. I think the one time he did, like, Michel was the guy late in the year in 2018 when they won the Super Bowl. He was pivotal. Like, he was their guy at the end of the year and in the playoffs. And I think that showed what he's capable of. I think that he's capable of more than what the Patriots ask of him. I think he is at I believe it was Georgia he came from, I think. Correct me if I'm wrong. But he was a better receiver than what he's been so far in the league because he just doesn't get opportunities like that in New England. They don't ask him to catch the ball, but from what I studied from him, he's a good receiver. And you know, he's one of those guys. He's a slasher, one cut, you know, and he's to the house. So I like Sony Michel. There are guys that I liked over him, but if you're targeting, like Tom, if you're targeting a guy around the area and you want Sony Michel, I like Brodo said, I don't have a problem with it. I just personally would take other guys before him for my team. But I've always liked Michel, and I don't put his down year in terms of production on him. It's just it's New England. You never know with New England.
True. Next pick. Who's up next? Pete Evans, the floor is yours, my man.
So, I feel like I got my star now in Saquon. I feel like Jonathan Taylor, who ran 4.39 at the 40, is the next breakout star. And with speed, size with speed. So, I'm torn between now, do I go get a bell cow back? One guy I'm looking at, yeah, he was in the top three of stats, but got hurt last year, was hurt the year before, only 25 years old. But how much wear and tear can you take on your body? Because when you're incorporating the team, we all talk about what's the best ability is your availability. That's your best attribute. I need you to be durable. Read to the guy I'm going to take. Played in AFC East, started 12 games, averaged 5.13 yards a carry, 775 yards. Had two rushing touchdowns, two passing touchdowns. His quarterback was already taken. So, who could be a running back, considered. Kev knows where I'm going. I'm going Devin Singletary here.
Damn.
Out of Buffalo.
Okay. All right. See, what go ahead, Pete, because there's one concern I have.
He's not a fast guy, but I'm looking at age here. He proved in the league last year he could do it. So he's 1 year removed from Jonathan Taylor. So you can talk about kids getting taken at 21. Devin Singletary is only 22 years old. Played in the AFC East, tough division to play in. Cold. So, and I'm looking at my quarterbacks too. I'm looking at my wide receivers, and I want fluidity through my offense. And I'm looking at, when I look at Aaron Rodgers, I'm going to have to throw the ball 30, 40 times. And I think it's going to be in some games. If we were, like we said, put it in the Madden tournament, where there's going to be games that we're going to be up in the fourth quarter. And I want somebody to drown out the clock. And I don't want to sacrifice Saquon's body for that. I don't want to sacrifice Jonathan Taylor's body for that. I'll sacrifice Devin Singletary's body for that, because even though he's not a bigger guy, he's not a big, big guy. He's only 203 pounds. He's elusive. He has good feet and he has good vision. And he can somewhat catch the ball out of the backfield. And he's proven that he can do it. Almost had 1,000 yards in 12 games. So that's it was tough because I probably left some players that you guys want, and it's probably not going to take that long for you guys to jump on it, like a Melvin Gordon, Leonard Fournette, or even Aaron Jones. We may hear these names come up in the next 15, 20 minutes, but I just thought about, once again, the team building aspect of it.
So my big concern, I love the kid. My big concern is that he already has so much wear and tear on him, not necessarily from the pros. Look at what they did to that kid in college.
Yeah, Florida Atlantic, yeah.
It's unprecedented what they did to that kid. So my concern is, and this is, it doesn't really matter in this exercise, because in this exercise, he's not in Buffalo. He's on Team Peter Evans. So you could be playing down in friggin' Florida and you're fine. But I worry about the kid because he already has so much wear and tear. And with him playing in that division, obviously in Buffalo, you know what I'm saying? To where a couple few years you get out of him, I think he's a special talent. But longevity, and I'm okay with it. It's not a bad pick because you're taking him with your third pick. So where you can afford to do this, but I would say for the people that, not necessarily you, but in the chat and everybody, you're saying, oh, well, he's taking this pick based off of youth. That's not the value in this pick, because he's not one of those guys a la Josh Jacobs or even somebody who's a rookie to where you're projected, you know, 7, 8, 9 years out of him. I would be shocked personally, just because of what he already had to do in his playing career in college and in the NFL.
Good point. Good point. That's what I'll take Jonathan Taylor in a second, though.
Yep, very true. So you're fine. So you're fine.
Yeah.
I mean, I personally, I love the pick. I mean, you saw the stain on my face because that was my pick there. To me, I don't even look at him as being, you know, halfback. To me, I line up as a fullback. I mean, he's 5'7", 210 pounds. So to me, that's a big boy. And that, you know, you put him back there with a, you know, an upright quarterback like you got, you know, takes that wear off a little bit. You know, he's, you know, cutting people at the line, you know, doing a little bit more of your blocking to, you know, help your running backs out back there. But you know that you can give him the ball, you know, 10 times a game. Those, you know, you very Marshawn Lynch-esque.
Who are you talking about right now?
Singletary. Devin Singletary.
You're comparing Singletary to Marshawn Lynch.
Here I said, well, if they would have given,
and you want to line up Devin Singletary as a fullback.
Yes.
Devin Singletary was often compared to Jalen Richard and LeSean McCoy coming out of the draft. He's a smaller, quick guy. He's not a power guy. Whoa.
I'm not saying he's necessarily
Buffalo drafted Zach Moss to be the complement to Devin Singletary. Yeah. Devin Singletary he's like more of a scat back guy. You're going to put a scat back at fullback and compare him to Marshawn Lynch?
I'm not saying that he's a full-on power back or your quote-unquote typical fullback, but he's 5'7", 200 pounds. That's a hefty guy. That's a small package to be 200 pounds. I mean, that's somebody that you could, you know, force through if you're the Seahawks, you know, throwing back to the Super Bowl where Marshawn would have made that touchdown one in the game. That's the situations I see Singletary being used. Somebody to throw that weight through. I'm not saying he's going to be the biggest guy out of the backfield, but he's the guy that's going to push you a couple yards here and there up the gut, you know, and not necessarily be your typical guy back there. You don't, you know, especially with the injury history and the longevity you have, you're going to have to use him a little bit outside the box to make that last. So yeah, that would be my vision with him.
I don't know, Kevin, you're using a smaller, yeah, he's 200 pounds. The muscle does like that weight is because he carries himself a certain way, but he's not a power back. You're going to smash up the gut. You tell that to Sean McDermott in Buffalo, he'll smack you.
Hey, like Chucks, leave Kevin alone. He's in Fiji. He's enjoying Fiji.
Oh God.
I mean, I am.
Don down the pool.
I thought you were talking about Jonathan Taylor at first. That was like,
I took him.
No, but what I'm saying, I thought he went back about Taylor, and I'm like, okay, maybe he's talking about Taylor. Put a Taylor in a fullback in some reps, kind of like how Howard, you know, did on that one run against Buffalo for the Eagles and, you know, had that really good lead block for Miles, like something like that on occasion. But when you talk about Singletary, fullback, I don't know, man. Like,
fullback, Taylor Bowers.
Like 230 at least Taylor. 230.
Taylor Bowers says, let's put Adrian Killens as a fullback next. who's next? Who's next?
I am.
Here we go.
This is tough. This is the last pick, so I can have more fun with this pick. What I will say is I am not going Kareem Hunt. If anyone wanted to guess that, no, I'm not going Kareem Hunt. He's still disowned, and I still can't trust him to be on any team right now. Not until he shows that he's grown up and matured. So even though I wanted him and the talent is there, I don't want him on my team because I can't trust him.
So, I know who you can trust, though. I know some guys you could trust.
No,
are you going young? You going pup? You going young pup?
There are three guys that I'm debating between. It's a young guy, a veteran, and still a rather young guy. So it depends on which route I want to go. It really does. trying to think this through.
We've got money on this, Chucks. Don't screw this up. We've got money on this.
Okay, so I'm gonna eliminate Aaron Jones, and I hate saying that because Aaron Jones would be one of like a top 10 running back to me. But if we're talking about running backs, he's already seasoned. So eliminating Aaron Jones. And the other guy between two guys, and one of the guys you guys would be very surprised at, and I'm really
– I don't think I will. I don't think I will.
Yeah, I don't know. Do I want to be predictable or do I want to
– No, go with your heart, Chucks. Go with your heart, please.
It depends on what predictable is. So, just go with your gut feeling.
Because I know who you guys are betting on, and – I want to pick him.
I have to tell you, Chucks had the running back guy had all the time in the world to prepare for the running back draft, and he can't decide any of his picks.
I know.
It's because he wants them all.
I like so many guys.
We're on the clock, Chucks.
I know.
Seven, all right. Six, five, four, three, two.
All right. I'm gonna go Philip Lindsay. Wow. I'm gonna skip over Clyde. I just think a theme for my team so far when we're talking about wide receivers and the team I have now is speed, and I want to keep that going. So yes, I was debating with Clyde, but I think I have two all around backs who can be dual threats. I want more speed to threaten. The threatened defenses, and Philip Lindsay is one of the fastest running backs in the league. I've always loved how he runs. He's like a maniac. Like they don't call him Tasmanian Devil for nothing. Like he gets the ball and he goes, and it's hard to bring him down. I've loved Philip Lindsay since he came in, so I'm gonna go Philip Lindsay.
Yeah, I was wrong on both aspects because I didn't think you were taking Clyde because I didn't think Clyde was gonna be here at this time. Okay. And I didn't have Philip Lindsay here. Do you want me, Kevin and Chrome? Do you want me to tell him what we were betting on?
Yeah,
I'm not taking either of them. So
same. I'm not touching.
I'm not touching those guys either. So,
go ahead. I would imagine Pete's not either. We are taking bets that you're either taking Matt Breida or Raheem Mostert.
No, no.
It's your boy Kyle. It's your boy Kyle Shanahan.
I said it. But at the same time, I don't know if I'll have Kyle Shanahan as my coach. We haven't gotten to that draft yet. And, they're system guys. Like, Raheem Mostert is a system guy. And Breida, like, he's a really good runner, but he has fumbling issues. That's why he lost his job. And he's not a great receiver. So I can't go with either of them. I'm surprised with that. That surprises me. You guys would. Well, no, I guess it shouldn't surprise me that you guys thought I'd go one of the Niners backs. But
I was going to say, it shouldn't surprise you.
Do you blame us?
Again, they're system guys. I'm drafting for Chucks' team and not the Niners Kyle Shanahan team.
We all know that the Chucks team is really the Philadelphia Eagles / 49ers light. Stop it. Stop it.
I'm not the one with Jimmy GQ, right?
Don't look at me. I wasn't taking him in the fifth round if he was
available. No, I know.
If I had any say, he would never have been a Niner. So that's just my two cents.
Well, they didn't pick up the phone for you, Kev.
I went Philip Lindsay. It was tough. I wanted to pick Clyde.
Jake Friel says, "What's up, boys? Did Chucks take Sanders round one?" Yes, he did.
Yes, he did.
You could see the cashier's window for your bet.
If anyone wants a recap of what happened when Chucks did that, well, just
yes.
You know what I love? If you find it back, he grabs onto the top of his shorts to make sure they don't fall down.
Listen, we're PG-13 here. We try and make sure that's a standard rating here.
Yes. Gotta keep it classy.
We didn't want any 50 Shades of Tom, if you know what I mean.
So we have Ryan, you're next, right?
See?
Yes.
I want to ask the audience here. I need some assistance here. I don't, but I'll get some feedback here. Do I go cute here, or do I go with a guy who's been disrespected for a little bit in this draft? Because I'm thinking I might go cute.
If you could go cute, but even if you went where I think you may go, I mean, your running backs are strong.
I know he's talking about with disrespected in the draft. I know exactly who he's talking about.
Yeah. It's either I go with the revenge story, someone who I think was disrespected in this draft so far, and honestly disrespected around the league, or do I turn heel for a couple minutes? Do I turn heel?
Heel, right?
Are you going to go Darius Geis?
No. People are telling me go bold. All right, I'll go bold.
Go bold. Have some fun.
I'm on the fun thing. I'm going to go with a guy who really hasn't had much fun the last couple of years. But before that, he was the guy. The guy. Hall of Fame type talent. Hell, he might still be with what he's accomplished. On top of what I already have, Ezekiel Elliott and Josh Jacobs. Hell, you can call my running back core the bad boys.
Because Lord.
At the end of the day, do I really need to rely on him if he's my third running back? Or whenever he wants to be an adult.
He's going my disowned son.
If he wants to be an adult and show up, we'd be glad to have him. And the defense will look in the camera and be like, oh, my damn. Do we have to do this today? Give me Kareem Hunt.
Give there me it Kareem is.
Pete already had it penned in.
I know, he did.
Well, give me Kareem Hunt. Again, I don't like him. We could talk hours and hours about the off-field stuff, but talent-wise, I'm not taking him as my number one. I would have to rely on my number one. Even my number two, Ezekiel Elliott, doesn't get hurt. He's always going to be there. Unless there's a suspension, which you never know. You have Josh Jacobs, who's the young guy. Obviously, you can groom him. You can have him do a lot of different things. Also reliable. Kareem Hunt, hey, you want to play today? We'll gladly have you.
Yeah.
I wouldn't want to face that team. I really wouldn't.
Talent-wise, he's an absolute steal because I think talent-wise, he's still an elite running back. I'd even argue he's still – just for talent, he's better than Nick Chubb. But the thing is, you can't trust him because of, you know, the maturity issues and, you know, everything else. And I'm still hurt over what he did. And I'm still healing. He was my guy. That's why I didn't take him. But, you know, for you and your team, it's you got an absolute steal. You have an elite talent as your third running back. So that's a great pick.
Don, he thought I was taking Le'Veon Bell. No chance in hell. I liked Le'Veon. Listen, I made the mistake of drafting him on my fantasy team last year, and we know how that panned out. No. And for anybody who doesn't know, disrespected, I was talking about Melvin Gordon. That was my other option.
Oh, that's not who I thought you were talking about.
Me either.
Well, I'm not wrong in your assessment either. Yeah. There's two people I think then that are really disrespected if you want to add Melvin Gordon to that, but I'll wait. I want to see where Kevin goes. Kevin, I got a really hard decision. I got four guys that I have in my head. Please take one of them off the board for me, please.
Unfortunately,
if you don't take
I'm
one
not
going to. You're an idiot.
Unfortunately, I'm not. And I believe that most of you are going to call me an idiot, but that's okay.
I know what you're doing. I know exactly what he's doing.
You guys aren't over here in Fiji, so you call me an idiot if you will. But I've got a guy in Dalvin Cook. Who, can catch the ball out of the backfield, a little bit of power. I got Nick Chubb, can catch the ball out of the backfield, a little bit more power. I'm going to add to that power. I brought up the position earlier. Give me a fullback. Give me Dan Vitale, who's going to be the next Kyle Juszczyk. Let me keep my quarterbacks upright.
I knew it. I friggin' knew it. Oh, I knew it.
Why didn't go to San Francisco and take that dude then?
7 years old. He's been in the league already. He's 29 now. I'm gonna take his successor in the position. So give me the guy a couple of years younger.
Like I feel like if this is a legit draft, dude, like we're the panel, if Lou Riddick and Mel Kiper and Todd McShay were up here, they'd be like, tape. I don't know who he took. I need some tape. I didn't even critique this player. I didn't evaluate him or anything.
He's a newcomer in New England, replacing No, he was played with Green Bay and brought him in from there. He actually played in Tampa before that.
Is he frozen?
No, he's just frozen with fear.
Did you say Vitale or Vitale? I can't even spell this shit.
Vitale.
On that note, I would like to trade all three off of Kevin. I'm going to take Kevin's lead here. I'm going to trade all three of my picks for future running back stud, and that's Jordan Mailata. Okay, I'm just going to take it. I'm just going to take Kevin's role here. See, he's ahead of the curve. Just screw friggin' Ezekiel Elliott and Josh Jacobs and even Kareem Hunt. Ah, I'll just take Jordan Mailata since we're going craziness here. Chuck's thoughts? No, we'll come
all
back.
Right, back.
We'll come back later.
Back to you, Chrome. No,
we'll come back later.
I got nothing.
All right.
No, he's not okay, Don. He's not okay. And neither am I.
That was last.
Probably back in his pool.
That's even outlandish for you, Kev. I mean, wow.
We're talking about building a backfield.
I don't give
a damn. We're talking about building a team, and to me, you know, we've talked about it before. I'm a power type guy, right? I want to, you know, be able to hit you where I can, and I like my deep threat, Michael Thomas. How do I get the ball deep to him? I keep the ball in my quarterback's hands. I'm going to need an extra guy back there to keep him upright.
Deep threat?
Oh, he can be.
If not him,
Stephon Diggs, pick your choice.
Got enough.
You should have said Diggs to start with. Michael Thomas is a deep threat. Is like saying I'm a deep threat. That's not.
I'm so speechless that I'm literally, my whole body is sweating from this. I'm like hot. I don't know how to react to this. I'm not even kidding. You can probably see like my head glistening. I started sweating when you made this pick. Holy
God. Can I just ask you something, Kev? Yep. And I'm probably going to regret asking this because I'm afraid to hear the answer. So you're talking about building teams, right?
Yes.
We're still playing that game.
Yep.
Building organizations, correct? Are you trying to win games, right? Not you're trying to tank for Trevor Lawrence, which I know the Patriots are trying to do. Like we're trying to
definitely
win games.
Win games.
Okay. On what planet, regardless of fit or position or whatever we're doing down in Fiji, is – what's his name? Something Batanzas? What is his name? Oh, no, that's a pitcher. It got me confused because, again, I have no idea who the hell this guy is. In what planet is Batanzas, Vitaly, whatever – better than Aaron Jones, Melvin Gordon, Austin Eckler, freaking me, Ralph, Chrome, Dom in the pool. In what planet?
See that's the great thing about what we're doing here is we're not picking people that are the best.
We're
not picking guys that are the best at their position.
Straight.
We're not taking guys that are talent as far as off the charts, what they have done in the past. I'm looking for the future. And on my team, that's going to be a fullback in Dan Vitale.
What future?
You did so well with the first two picks.
Threw it all away.
Hey, and that's your opinion. I'll see you in the playoffs. Don't worry.
Don't you dare say Broad Street. Don't you friggin' dare. I'll fly down to Fiji.
Kevin, if you wanted to take a fullback, why didn't you take the best fullback in the game?
We're going off of age.
I just looked it up just for shits and giggles. You know what Dan Vitale's rating is on Madden? It's a 66.
Hey, fine by me.
Why do you need a fullback too? You can,
like,
you
and I'm not trying to judge a player on Madden ratings. I'm just it was just like I hardly hear of this guy. And you, so
for you can use a backup tight end. You can use a freaking tight end for this. You can use an offensive lineman for this.
Like, what the hell? If you wanted to go with a fullback, I would have at least been like, okay, I understand the direction you're going if you picked Juice. If you went with Kyle Juszczyk, who's the best fullback in the game and can be used in multiple ways, a multidimensional weapon as a fullback, then I would have been like, it's a reach, but I understand. And plus you have Jimmy GQ as your backup, so you won that connection. But you went with a fullback that no one knows of? That like there are probably other fullbacks
I guarantee.
That are better than him. What about that guy? There's that guy Ham in, I think, in Minnesota. CJ something Ham, I think. I forget what his name is. I'm sorry. But he's even better than Vitaly.
I guarantee this is a different conversation, you know, come the end of the season when you the position changes up in New England. They just had Devlin retire. They're bringing this kid in. You'll see very Kyle Juszczyk-esque play out of him.
Are you going to start wearing hoodies now, Kev? Are
you, I've got one.
He's got the cutoff hoodie.
You might
I do.
As well put it on and sit while you're in Fiji and wear a cutoff hoodie because that's what you're trying to think. Like, hell, you could have drafted Ralph Dalvecchio as your fullback out of BCU, basic college university, for all I care.
Is he available? This fucking guy. Is Ralphie available? He's big enough to throw him back there.
I'll tell you what, he plays for cheap. He plays for cheap, I'll tell you that right now.
Ralph, you out there, bud?
Yeah. Hey, Frank, I know you're in the back end. Get Ralph in here.
I got to tell you guys, I would have never thought I'd be in this situation at this point.
Dude.
Particularly, I begged for Kevin to please take one of these guys. I never thought I would be. I honestly don't know what to do, and I have the very last pick. Because I would have never expected that Aaron Jones would still be on the board, that Eckler would be on the board, that Clyde would still be on the board, that Melvin Gordon would still be on the board.
Nope.
Hell, I'm even looking at a guy like, you know, when we're talking youth, I'm even looking at a guy like a David Montgomery, who was sixth, you know, in his rookie year and didn't start last year and was sixth amongst running backs in carries within the 5-yard line. You know, and I'm looking at youth. He's a 22-year-old kid who I think, you know, is on a really shitty team and I think would be a lot more productive if he was elsewhere. I mean, Kenyon Drake is still out there. I'm like, Jesus, God, I don't know who to pick. I don't know what direction to go in.
Got a lot of good running backs in the league.
You are blessed, my child.
You could have done me a massive favor here.
You are blessed. You are blessed, my child.
There are a lot of good running backs in the league.
There's and also a couple fullbacks, you know, out there, too, if you're interested.
I have to – you know, I want to go – part of me wants to go either Clyde or Montgomery for the youth aspect of things. But Alvin Kamara is still a fairly young guy at 24. So I have to go with a guy who has slipped – all who could have been a first-round or high second-round talent. I have to take him.
Yep.
And it's got to be Aaron Jones. It's impossible. And I feel like even if I technically needed another need at this point, I feel like it's disrespectful to the season that he put together last year to not say Aaron Jones's name. And I believe that the injury issues and Pete was talking about a lot earlier is definitely a concern. But as my third back, it would be a travesty. And despite Melvin Gordon and the great talent he is, it would be an absolute disrespect for Aaron Jones not to get taken by somebody in this draft. So for that purpose alone, with the last pick, I will take Aaron Jones as my third running back to pair with Alvin Kamara. And
Hey, Tom, did you you want us to kind of fill you in on what?
Please tell me you caught any of you caught Kevin's last pick.
I don't want him to catch it. I want this to be raw.
Yeah,
I want this
to you be know? First time. Tom, do you know?
I'm looking right now. Dan Vitale?
That is correct.
Are you bringing the fullback back?
Yes, I am.
I got to go back in here?
Double dip.
Mike,
Do I really got to go back in here again?
You might, just to clean off all the sin that, that Kevin has put in this show.
That might be a, like, you might need to dip twice.
to double dip, out. Just for all the...
I might not need to, I might not need to come out of that one.
Again, wow.
The fact that
I'm freaking still sweating
Dylan,
from it.
The fact that Dylan freaking Batali, Dylan Betances was drafted, but Melvin Gordon wasn't. I don't know what to do. I don't know what to do with myself right now.
And then TA, he had the audacity to call Michael Thomas a deep threat.
Oh yeah,
he can be.
Yeah, we heard that earlier. I sort of just let that one go on his first time around.
Yeah, no Chris Carson either. That's true. No Chris Carson.
Left off the board. Kenyon Drake. I love Kenyon Drake.
Yeah.
Like, there's a lot.
No Clyde. No Clyde.
Drafted. So I'm
Vitaly with, like, I would rather take Boston Scott in that situation. I think you would probably got less heat.
Yeah.
Take friggin' Jordan Mailata.
Honestly, I really thought that he was going to take Aaron Jones. I felt like he was going to really try to have, like, one of the steals of the draft and come out of this and say, hey, nobody gave me any shit for anything that I picked. When he said that, Nate, I wanted him to take Aaron Jones so I could actually have to make a decision on one of these other – I probably would have gone Clyde. I have to take Aaron Jones. You can't not take Aaron Jones at that point.
Yep.
I really wanted you to take Aaron Jones, Kevin, really freaking badly.
We were rooting for you, Kev.
Well, a guy who did a great job up until then, you know, was really redeeming himself.
Oh, my goodness.
And then you totally ruined it. You know, I would go take a dip in that Fiji water.
Yeah, go walk on water, Kev.
Get some salt in your body. Go get a little salt.
Hey, take a stroll.
Don't worry. We got plenty of room down here for you guys, you know, after you come congratulate us on our championship win. It's okay. You know, it is tough being the smartest guy in the room, but I will bear that cross. Don't worry.
It must be a one man island.
Only one in the room.
That must be a one man island.
Where's Wilson at? Wilson has to be underneath the chair or on the side of the dock or something, buried in the sand. Maybe y'all playing hide and seek again. I don't know what you're doing.
Oh my goodness, man.
So I'm gonna run through. We'll name our three. Actually, Pete, do you have it right in front of you? All the like everybody's. Yeah, run through everybody's teams.
I wrote it down too. So
at Tom, we had CMC first pick, second round Sony Michel, third round DeAndre Swift. We had myself, yours truly, Saquon, Jonathan Taylor, Devin Singletary. We had Chucks take his son, Miles Sanders. Joe Mixon and Philip Lindsay, track team. Then we had Kev. Kev. Who went fourth? You or Kev?
No.
I went four.
All right. So at four, we had Ryan go Zeke, Josh Jacobs, and then convict number 12345, Kareem Hunt.
Bad boys.
Then Kev went Dalvin Cook, A+. Nick Chubb, A+. Dylan Betances, Dan Vitale.
There you go.
Man. I don't even know what grade
you're lower than an F, bro. Lower than an F. That's
an incomplete. That's an incomplete.
Expulsion.
A+.
I'm almost to the point where, like, Kevin, I want to have us vote right now. The first time in BOF draft history. Let's put a vote to it. Can we give this guy another shot to get the shit right?
Chucks, I'll tell you why I say yes. I want to see him screw it up again. That's why I want to see him screw it up four times. Okay, not just three. I want it four.
Four times in three rounds.
Yes, I want to see it again.
All right, Kev, we're gonna give you a chance to let him redraft that pick.
You got a mulligan.
Redraft the pick. Do I get to keep my fullback?
First of all, Kevin, no you don't. Kevin, you could keep you could keep him, but that's you saying again that you are a second time around. You would do this a second time. First question is Don wants to know if you're still hiring interns.
The answer is yes. You do get your own hut. So, you know, You can apply at KFC, you know, fanclub.com. And this one back here is available, actually.
Fan club. It's technically Kevin's fan club. Fan club.
Yeah.
Hey,
I'm going to sign executive order. This is executive order day. You know, the last 2 months of an executive orders. I'm going to sign an ATV executive order. And that is, I'm letting you keep your stupid fullback and still giving you another chance.
Yes. So
that's the executive order sign right now.
Wow.
The guy stinks. So please pick again and keep him. And let's see if you redeem yourself at all.
If I get to keep my fullback, the guy I would have gone here is Kenyon Drake.
All right.
No, Chuck, don't say all right. My dog. And Chuck just said, my wife's trying to get rid of you. He probably just wanted to get rid of you and said, all right, because what are you doing? We gave you a chance. And you got Drake. Kenyon Drake. Oh, I can't. Are you guys good with that pick? Still?
No.
There's still guys on the board here that are better. And he missed.
He still didn't take Melvin Gordon. Melvin Gordon still hasn't been taken.
That's fine by me. Did you see what Kenyon Drake did last year at the end of the season when in an actual system and not down there in a haze of Miami stupidity?
But he's in your system.
Right. Exactly.
Kevin, if you wanted a power back, it's right here. Chris Carson is one of the best power backs in the league.
I was looking for a power back. I'm keeping my fullback.
You took a fullback.
Exactly. Did you guys not hear the executive order? It was to keep my fullback. So I don't have to go that way anymore.
I think he had a chance to get an extra player, and he screwed it up. So you lose Kenyon Drake, and you stick with that goddamn fullback now. You couldn't get it right.
By me.
Listen, he just talked
about – you would have taken Melvin Gordon, we would have said go for it.
He just said, did you see what Drake did at the end of the year? Have you been seeing what Melvin Gordon's done his whole career? The whole thing. Not his end of the year stuff. The whole thing. Dire thought. Have you seen that?
Right. Were you watching?
Sneaky Hut?
I have seen.
He's getting blurrier.
But I have seen what he's done. But, you know, as you said, he's had a whole career. It's time for him to take the other Hut back on this side, go retire, have fun. You know, give me the younger guy. Give me Kenyon Drake.
I think it's raining there in Fiji. I think it's raining.
Oh, it never rains.
Well, something's on the screen. It's probably all that sin.
I was just in Fiji. Yes, it does rain. Come down. I can't.
Wow. Okay.
Well, that was fun.
So I'll ask you guys in the fam at home, out of the guys who weren't selected in the draft, who do you think was the one that was the biggest miss type thing to where it's a shock? It's the biggest shocker that they weren't drafted.
For me, there's two names. We've said the obvious, which is why I'll say a second, which is Melvin Gordon.
Mm-hmm.
The second would probably, if you're looking at young guys, I like Clyde a lot. Yeah. So I'm a little bit shocked just kind of seeing the trends of how we've done our drafts that Clyde didn't go. And again, if Kevin would have taken Aaron Jones, I would have still passed on Melvin and gone for Clyde. But I think that those are probably your two biggest missed names in this draft.
It was a toss-up for me, Clyde and Lindsey. So, yeah. Clyde not going was a surprise. I'll say that.
I thought there was a chance you were going to take him at 10, Chucks.
Oh, Clyde, Mixon was too good to pass up, man. Mixon there, like, yeah. He fell to me at 10. I was like, I typed it in real quick.
I mean, for me, I would say Chris Carson because I was really close to taking him. But like you stated, we're talking about building something for years to come. And just his last two seasons, he's just been banged up. We're not talking about like minor injuries. I mean, they've been major injuries. So just, you don't know how long a guy like that's going to last. You know, we talked about it with Christian McCaffrey, obviously on a completely different level, not saying anywhere near that Chris Carson is near Christian McCaffrey, but Chris Carson has had success in this league for 3 or 4 years of being a 7th round pick. I'm also shocked to be honest. I mean, do we think no Le'Veon Bell, no Leonard Fournette, no Marlon Mack? You know what I mean? So, I mean, half of the top 10 that put up stats last year, we didn't take because we all have that eye to the future.
Yep. Yeah, the two biggest surprises for me, other than obviously the Melvin Gordon one, Eckler a little bit. I would have been very confident Austin Eckler would have been taken here, just because he really jumped off the page when he was when we talk about opportunity, when Melvin Gordon was obviously out and he wasn't playing last year. You know, Austin Eckler was a top three running back in the league. I think he was top two, maybe best running back fantasy wise in the league. So, you know, when you look at how many things he could supply, to be honest, I was thinking about taking him at one point at nine, honestly, kind of taking like a 1-2 punch because he was able to take, you know, he's able to catch passes in the backfield, do a lot of things, kind of a perfect complement to somebody like Zeke. But for him to not even go at all, I was kind of surprised. And then on your point too, Pete, and that's Leonard Fournette. I'm not, you know, we can say all we want about the guy, but you know, I mean, the guy's really freaking good, really good.
Yeah.
I mean, if you talk about stats last year, especially, you know, in a guy I looked at in the third round, just as age to train up, you know, the younger pups that we all took early on, you know, our first, second year guys, is a guy like Mark Ingram, who has had a, you know, sneaky, quiet career and had a fantastic year last year, not necessarily having to be the lead back while his quarterback did that for him. So that was a guy I was surprised out on top of Eklund.
The fact that he's older, I think.
That's where the difference was, because I considered, in terms of the exercise, right, I still want to win right away. And having Alvin Kamara – having Derrick Henry, knowing the dynamic of Ingram and Kamara works, I considered a little bit taking him at the end, but the age was just way too much of a factor. And again, I mean, Aaron Jones was
Aaron Jones, yeah.
I can't let him not get drafted.
Yeah. Don,
he but there was a consideration for Ingram.
Don was going to brought up a name I was actually going to mention just now, but for an opposite reason, because I was going to say, it's kind of really funny that no one is saying James Conner, and it kind of like validates me, because all last year, like, what was it, like 2018, when Bell was sitting out and Conner was getting all those stats, everyone was like, oh, Conner's elite, he's just as good as Le'Veon. And I thought that was preposterous. Like, Conner's a solid guy, he's a solid running back, he's good, great story behind him. But I don't think he is, talent-wise, he's as good as people like were making him out to be. He just had stats. So seeing what he had to do this past year, when he had no, you know, there was no AB and there's no Le'Veon, and the defenses were crowding boxes to stop him. He's not that focal point type of running back. You know, he's a situational guy, and you know, it kind of validates my point from last year that he wasn't mentioned and he wasn't even considered, you know, by, you know, in the chat room until probably just now.
Yeah, I'm right there with you, Chuck. This is a guy that when he first came out, you know, kind of looked like, oh my God, where this guy come from? You know, why is he doing this? But it made sense in, you know, 2018, when you have a guy that's beating you over the top every time and getting doubled in AB. Then you've got a guy like Juju, who's the perfect slot in that system to cut out underneath. So, you know, that leaves that essentially leaves him unblocked up front, to where you make the decision at the line, you know, based on read what you're going to do. When you take that threat out over the top away, and you make Juju, who's a slot guy, play number one, you know, there's no pressure to not, you know, have a guy there and covering him. So to me, I see him outside the top 15, maybe a top 20 guy, but, you know, hasn't proven that he can really carry a team or a backfield.
Yeah, besides whatever freaking fullback you took, you know, I don't think there's any bad picks here. You know, I know there's going to be guys left off the board, and every one of them guys is an aging guy, essentially, or a little bit older, a little bit longer in the tooth. So everybody understands the exercise. You know, you're trying to build a team for the future, not for just next year, but 5 years from now. So when you look at that, you expect some guys to get left off. You know, I consider taking Le'Veon Bell, but he's a little older. He's got wear and tear. So, you know, I just think that's part of it. But I got to run, boys, but you guys obviously have fun finishing up and a ton of fun drafting backs again. And then what's our next one?
Oh, like, we got defense next week.
We got defense. So defense. It's going to be fun. So we'll see how these teams shake out. So,
yeah.
Good shit, boys. I got to go handle some things. I don't know what's going on. Guy. I'm just going to jump out on a blank screen here.
See ya. Later, boys.
See you, brother.
So my question to you guys in the fan at home. Go ahead, Carl.
Well, I just real quick on the James Conner thing. I just think the league caught up to him. You know, I agree with Chuck's. I'm Le'Veon Bell ready to step into his shoes immediately and make a similar kind of impact guy. I think it was a lot of fool's gold. I think the league caught up to him last year and he didn't make the proper adjustments. I think he's a good back in the right system. Or in a right rotation, he could be an asset. But I would have never even considered him to go in this draft.
No. Yep. I agree.
Yeah, no.
I agree.
Not enough upside.
My question for you guys.
And the other point. Go ahead. The other point, too, that Tom made when he talked about names off, he's right. A lot of it, in terms of the exercise and what we're looking to do, you know, some of these names that were left off, there's age on there and there's injury issues.
Yeah.
Again, look at a name like Chris Carson, the injury issues over the last 2 years. There's some that went that we had to bring up the fact that there's an injury risk. There might be guys that slid because of the injuries. Aaron Jones would be one of them. I think if Aaron Jones hadn't had the injury issues that he's had over the last few years, I think Aaron Jones would have went a lot earlier instead of falling to the last pick of the draft. You know, David Johnson's a guy who was an absolute elite top one or two or three running back in this league up until 2 years ago when he got crushed with injuries.
Yep.
So, you know, it's a big factor that when you start looking at that stuff in terms of the exercise of why certain guys are going to be off the board.
Two quick questions for mm-hmm. the fam and obviously, the people in here before we head out of here. We'll start with the first and then we'll move to the second one eventually. Each of you give me your most overrated and underrated running back. And it could be guys that are in this draft or guys that were missed, for example. But we'll start with overrated. Each of you give me, and the fam at home, your most overrated running back in the league. Whoever wants to start first.
This is tough.
It's really tough.
Give us give me like a minute.
While you're doing that, I'll go through chat. I'll go through the chat.
Overrated. I'm going to, you know, maybe overrated. And I just want to say, because I don't know that he's the same guy, but people still talk about him like he's a top like two or three. And it's Leonard Fournette. I don't know that I believe Leonard Fournette is the guy that he was 2 years ago, but people still talk about him like he was the same guy he was 2 or 3 years ago. And almost every year, there's still an expectation, like this year. I don't know that he's ever going to be that same guy. I don't know that his head's on right. I don't know that I feel like anybody's, like, super overrated. If I was to look at someone in terms of the fans' eyes, I would say Leonard Fournette.
I'd have to agree I second what Chrome said for overrated.
For me, it's Le'Veon. You talk about a guy that hasn't been who he was 2 or 3 years ago, got that money, came in. I think last training camp, when pre-COVID, he came in at, 250, 260? Like, he had completely let himself go, and you could tell throughout the season. And once again, that's what I think. We just talked about it with Connor. It was a marriage of things. With the most elite out of those players, when that offense was really hitting, it was really AB was the one who could do – he could have went to any team and been as successful. But you saw the others weren't as successful without him. And then when you start taking pieces away, it wasn't the same. It just wasn't the same. And Le'Veon, I mean, when you talk about overrated, I definitely think he's in that category with Leonard Fournette.
I think
I agree. I agree, Pete. I completely agree. I think a lot of people and Chucks and I, you know, we've been talking about it for years on the Tuesdays that, you know, going back, you know, with his contract negotiations, more so his demands to where, you know, he was regarded both in his own mind, I think throughout the league as, you know, and he's a very good running back. He was, I should say. I don't know what's going on right now. I don't know if it's more about the Jets. I don't know if it's more about him. We'll find out this year because the Jets obviously put some pieces together around him finally. But when you talk about Le'Veon, he wanted all this guaranteed money, and he was never able to, as I've always said, supply guarantees, whether that was him staying out of trouble, whether that was him obviously staying healthy, because obviously he had two major injuries, he missed seasons. And then when he came back, it was all this hype, oh, my God, I'm going to end up being – I'm going to show Pittsburgh what they missed. And he had an okay year. He was fine. He was okay last year. Yeah. Again, I don't – we'll truly know this year whether it was all about the Jets not being very good or whether it was him. I don't know. But he's definitely taken a huge drop. But and I think a lot of people still put him up there, you know, around top five, top seven. And I just think that's crazy.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think it's really cool. Like with running backs, that's the thing. With running backs, the shelf life of them is so short. And they can you're thinking about what you're doing. You're constantly you have the ball in your hands almost as much as a quarterback. Like you have it like 15 to 20 times a game. You're touching it a lot. And then you're running away from defenders, you're getting beat up all the time. And so the shelf life, that's why the shelf life of running back is so small. And if you lose, like if you're one year where you're not in tip top shape, you lose it. Like you lose it. That little bit of I'll just use this as like a measure, but like if you lose like a half a, like a millisecond off your 40 time or for your speed, that means a whole lot for the running back position. And so like someone like Lev Bell, you know, he was elite in Pittsburgh. And I thought, you know, I really do believe he was one of the biggest reasons why that Pittsburgh offense was so successful. But when you take that year off and you go to a new team with a bad O-line, the way he ran his vision, you guys know, like he runs with like a lot of patience. He waits and he waits. When you don't have that kind of chemistry, or you're not as in sync with your O-line as he was with Pittsburgh's, a lot of your production go out the window. So that did a lot with it. Like I still think he's good from what I've seen, but I don't think like he's definitely lost a step, and his vision has to now tweak and adjust to that Jets O-line. So he's not the same back as he was before. In terms of overrated, someone I will say before we get to the underrated, but for overrated, I'm going to throw out a Philly guy here and say Corey Clement, just specifically for Philly fans, because Philly fans, I'm tired of it. Tired of Philly fans making him out to be a superstar in the making just because he had a big game in the Super Bowl. It's annoying. And I like Corey Clement as a situational guy, but fans, Eagles fans overrate him so much. So I'm going to call out Corey Clement.
My biggest overrated guy, a guy that I don't even see in the top 10 anymore, and we're talking about, you know, leaning into what you guys have said as far as availability and durability at the running back position, that's Mr. Half a Knee and Todd Gurley. There's still guys that see him as a top five back and who can, you know, going into a new system down in Atlanta, strong arm quarterback, you know, they've obviously got a little bit better of a line. They're going to hold something up behind him. I think he's going to fizzle out and do nothing. You know, I think that they're going to need to bring in somebody because that's not going to work. They've got no one else back there anymore with him. So, you know, to me, that was a flash in the pan. That worked for the, you know, 2-3 years he had both knees, but, you know, I think he's better off, taking the train down here, hopping in one of my huts, and calling it quits.
You cannot catch a train to Fiji, sir.
Well, a train, then a plane, then a boat. It you wouldn't get it, Pete. Don't worry.
For underrated, I'll just start out because I'll continue to argue this.
Brian, let me start out just because.
Yeah, go ahead.
My phone is extremely hot.
Okay.
And I think that's why I had the issue of getting booted the first time. So I'm going to give my underrated, and then I'm going to let you guys finish the show.
Okay.
Plus, I can't hear Kevin anyway. And I'm not doing the in and out thing.
Yeah.
We're back to this, boys. My underrated would be it's a guy that, you know, I think came out as one of the best running backs in his draft. He missed his entire rookie year. came back last year and had, I think he played four or five games, but ended up having a nice showing for himself. And I think could be one of the best, one of the better top tier running backs in this league, but I don't think he's ever in a conversation. And that's Darius Geis. I think Darius Geis could be a running back in this league. I think Darius Geis is going to be an elite running back. I think he could be a top 10 running back in this league. People forget about him because he missed his entire rookie year. And he missed, I think, 10 or 11 games last year. But if you look at his numbers, he averaged 5.8 carries last year and had two rushing touchdowns in five games. I think that – and Ryan and Chucks knows this because I think we've all kind of been on the Geis bandwagon since before he was drafted. I haven't jumped off. I know he had the injury issues, but I'm not ready to jump off of that bandwagon yet.
Agreed.
For me, I think without question, the most underrated running back who's never in a conversation. With that, boys, I love you guys. Chucks, you take care of the sponsors at the end of the show.
Will do.
Fam, good night. I'll see you guys next week when we do the draft, and I'll listen to the end of here. What shenanigans Kevin throws out here from
God.
Love you guys. See you later.
Good one. That's a very good one because Geis, you remember I was high on him too. He's got to just stay healthy. If he stays healthy, he will be a beast. I really do believe that. So I agree.
I'll go here real quick. It's somebody I've been saying for a while. I still think he's underrated. Hell, I was somewhat expecting him to go in our draft. I wasn't going to take him. I'm not that high on him. But to me, it's Jordan Howard. It's Jordan Howard. Okay. He's the guy that's always kind of forgotten, but when he's on the field, he delivers. Now, I understand last year we only saw him for half the season, but when he was on the field, it's pretty self-explanatory what he did for us. You know, obviously for the Bears, he was given no opportunity 2 years ago because they switched molds. They were saying, oh, he doesn't fit the offense. What doesn't fit to any offense when the guy literally just continues to get yards, 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 yards? That's all he does. That's all he does. Obviously, a couple years ago when they actually gave him an opportunity, he was very, very good. To me, I think they're really going to miss him. The Eagles, that is, I think they're really going to miss him this year. I would have loved to have had him back. And I'm not just saying this because, obviously, he was on the Eagles. I just think he's a guy that he's just – whenever he's on the field, he delivers, and nobody really talks about
him. I think for – if you're talking about just Eagles fans, he's overrated. I think in the grand scope of the NFL and the league, though, and fans and everyone, you know, league-wide, I think he is underrated. I will say that. Because I think he is what he is. Like, to me, Jordan Howard is a type of guy where you can find multiple runners like him because he's a one-dimensional guy. He's not a great receiver. He is just what he is. And that's, an extremely good power back who's going to fall forward on contact, and he's going to get those tough yards, and he's a strong guy. And if you need to just, you know, go forward and get chunk yards, you know, little by little, he's the guy that you want on first and second down and running downs. So I agree. He is what he is, but what he does it very, very, very well.
Okay.
Yeah. Do you have any underwrite? Oh, yeah, you guys.
My underrated, even though he was drafted in this draft, he was drafted in the second round, but it's not so much because he doesn't have value around the league. It's just that his entrance into the league knocked him down a couple steps. And I really believe like this player is on an elite level and should be talked about in the top 3, 4, 5 running backs in this league. And to me, that's Joe Mixon. Mm. He came in the league. I wanted the Eagles to draft him so bad. I was in Philly that night at the draft, like, okay, he's falling. Take him. Because if you look at his combine at the backfield coming out of Oklahoma, he was a do-it-all. He's a three-down back. But you hear him talked about. Don't get me wrong. You hear him talked about. But you don't hear him talked about as that elite level in the ire of Zeke, Saquon, and Christian McCaffrey. And dare I say, I mean, we all see it. In Cincinnati, what he's doing. And his first year, he struggled, but he started to come on late last year. But I just think that he needs that push from the public to be in that elite level. But once again, when you have that impression on you, we all seen the tape before, what happened in that Oklahoma establishment, how he acted, regardless of what was said, you can't unsee that. So that definitely has a lasting impression and has kind of stained his reputation. And really, but his talk on the football field, his skill set, to me, is elite in this league. It really is.
Yeah, I agree. That was going to be my underrated guy, is Joe, the guy that I took. And I already talked about him when I picked him, but it's the truth. Talent-wise, I'd say he's right there with the elite guys. You watch him play, and when he has daylight, boy, he can move. Oh, he can move, and he creates as much as he can in Cincinnati. I can just hope. I'm hoping that they build like a solid team so that he can get more recognition out there, because you know he deserves it. He's a talented guy.
Yes.
So for me, this one was a little bit tough to pick. I might be just a little bit higher on him than most, hence me picking him here as my underrated guy.
And this Kansas. Is
no, this is
Lamar Jackson.
Taking into consideration overall talent and usability within the scheme he's in is Kerryon Johnson. Now I know there's not much film on him because he has missed time. But as far as being on the field and what he's done in a very, very pass-first offense, has been bar none. I mean, he had 800 rushing yards within 10 games the first year, a little less last year, having less time played. But that's in a very play-from-behind, pass-the-ball-first type offense that they've got there. So if he plays a full season, I think he's he's your rushing record holder right there. Right there with Christian McCaffrey, depending on how many times they decide to throw him the ball. But to me, that's a guy when healthy is top five in the league.
All righty.
I disagree with that. I definitely disagree with that. I don't think he's a top five running back. I don't think he's close to that. So
I mean, I get that, and it's tough. And again, that was tough to say because of you. There's nothing I can really put precedent on wise to say that. Because he hasn't played a full season yet to show it, where he could be close. But my gut says he could be there.
Can I ask you, and again, it's going to be a question that I'm going to regret asking because I'm going to get the answer. So can I ask you, I just have one more question for you, Kev.
Yep.
So it's kind of a two-parter, maybe a three-parter. We'll see how this goes.
No, there's no room back here for you.
No. I'm good. I don't need a hut or whatever. It's a villa, first of all. It's a villa, not a hut. So when you're talking to the interns, it's a villa.
It's an overwater bungalow.
Yes, it's not a hut. Do you know what a hut is?
Yes, these are
huts. No, that's not a hut.
And I have a message from my dear wife who knows all. She says that those are the Maldives, Kevin, not Fiji.
See, you don't even know where you're at. You don't even know where you're at.
I was asleep. The interns drove. Okay.
They drove for what?
They
drove. You guys don't understand. Did they drive the submarine?
No, the yacht. They drove the yacht.
Oh, you got a yacht now?
Drive
a yacht. Guy thinks he's in freaking Fiji.
Drive, pilot, captain, whatever you want to use.
Thing's about to sink, I'll tell you that. Whatever the hell it is, boat, plane, friggin' yacht, bungalow, hut, it's about to sink. It's about to sink.
He's driving a yacht.
What I was going to ask you before that happened was, so part one, so you said you believe, your gut feeling says Kerryon could be a top five running back, correct?
Yeah.
Okay. Thought you said that. Second part, if you think, okay, if you think he can be a top five running back, why aren't you picking him?
Because I already had running backs, listed three and four on my list. So
did I, but I still took them.
Well, that's, that's your opinion.
No, that's not an opinion. That's what happened. That's a recap.
Kenyon Drake is higher ranked in your mind, Kev, than Kerryon Johnson.
I didn't say that.
Oh, you did by your actions. Actions speak louder than words.
See, you're taking it out of context here. I took Dalvin Cook and then Nick Chubb. Two top five guys in my opinion. Then, when given the option to keep my fullback to bolster speed within my size, I took a speedy guy. I didn't want another Kerryon Johnson. I took a flyer. If you're telling me if I was to redo this and Dalvin Cook and Nick Chubb were off the board, then I might look at
Johnson. So you passed on the top five guy in your book for a speed guy when you could have had three running backs who are in your top five.
Wait. Just second question. Another question. Question number 50, whatever question we're on right now. Recap the reason why you didn't take him with your second pick, because you wanted what?
Why I didn't take him with my second overall pick?
Yes. Recap the words that you said.
Because I have both Dalvin Cook and Nick Chubb at 3 and 4 over Kerryon at 5.
So you said you wanted speed over size, correct? With that second,
I didn't say that. That's where I took, when given the redraft option, I took Drake.
Okay. My friggin' point is, if we're worried about speed and they were worried about size, why are we taking a fullback? Why are we taking a fullback?
Because that was after the fact. I still have a second chance at life, Devin.
You were given a second chance. That was off of the board. That was a bonus. That was a pair of teeth. That was an appetizer.
You guys might want to go back and watch the tape, because executive order, one gives me the ability to keep my fullback. So I take the speed guy. If I don't have my fullback there, I might take another big guy and not the speed.
Why are you taking a flyer on a speed guy when you have your fifth ranked running back available?
Exactly.
Because you can't.
Third and fourth.
And you even, I know, before you, because I know what you're going to try and do. Before you go to, I wanted a guy who was younger and maybe somebody who is not, obviously, somebody who doesn't have a lot of tape on him. You just said Kerryon Johnson doesn't have a lot of tape on him. So what are we talking about?
I can't.
Listen, you guys won't understand it up there. When you come down here.
Planet Earth, I guess not, Mr. Fiji / whatever submarine driving we do.
Maldives / Mars.
Wherever you're at.
Hold on a second.
Yeah, get the notes.
As one of you.
Listen, guys.
Oh, Jesus. He's teleporting. Oh.
Guys, step in, grab a book, learn a lesson. Well, you got to mix it up a little bit, guys.
What are you, the Reading Rainbow? Take a look, grab a book.
Look, I'm the guy that's got all the trophies. Okay?
Good God.
We know a little bit something about winning.
What are they, fifth place participation trophies?
He stole those trophies from me, ladies and gentlemen. It's a fact. I have it on camera.
They're participation trophies.
Yeah, that's a good I'm job not sure. Today.
I can't remember. There's so many of them that I just don't remember exactly what they're all from.
Oh, God.
Chuck's get us the hell out of here. Aneurysm on the air.
Well, guys, everyone, thank you so much for tuning in again. Next week, we will continue. Don't worry, we still got more drafting. We got 2 more weeks left of this. Next week, we will be doing defense. And the week after, to cap it off, we will be doing coaches. So, what's up? 3 weeks? Defense and coaching.
Is it still rumored that we're doing the over 30 draft?
We have to decide that. We have to see.
Okay, so it's 2.5. It's not 2. It's not 3.
It's 2/3. We'll see about we'll see how we decide. But you did definitely get at least 2.
But real quick, Chucks, let them know how we're doing a defensive draft next week. So we're not just drafting a whole defense.
Yeah. So
three rounds. Go ahead.
If you guys, whoever's still tuned in. What we're going to do is we're going to mix it up a bit. We're going to make it very interesting. So we're going to go 3 rounds, and each of us has to pick 1 defensive lineman, 1 linebacker, and 1 defensive back. They can be in any order, though. So we don't have to take a certain position and in a certain round. We just have to make sure once the 3 rounds are done, we have 1 of each position. So that's going to make it very interesting to see, where you value – certain guys at certain positions, how you want to build, for that, for those 3 rounds. So it's going to be a lot of fun. I'm really, really looking forward to that draft next week.
So breaking, Kevin's going Stephon Gilmore, Stephon Gilmore, Stephon Gilmore. Right, Kev?
I mean, if I'm being honest, if I have the number one pick, you can already pencil that in. So, you know, there's no surprises.
He's
going,
there you go,
Damien. He's going Stephon, Steph, and Steven.
And Stephanie, if we go to the fourth. Stephanie. If we go to the fourth pick.
Oh, Don. Hey, maybe I will take Slay. I'm just kidding. I probably wouldn't take Slay. But we'll see. We'll see how it goes out next week. But we do appreciate everyone. We hope you guys had fun this week. It was definitely a blast. And again, we had more fun poking fun at Kev, because we know that out of all of us, at least we're not going to be in last place. He will be. But thank you, everyone, for tuning in. Tune in tomorrow. Ryan, you still got your show tomorrow?
Yeah, we've got a big combined show. We're going to be doing the Philadelphia Eagles NFC East ranking show. We're going to be going 1 through 4 on all of the positions, and we're going to be going through Eagles, Cowboys, Giants, Redskins, going 1 through 4 and seeing where each team ranks up among each position group.
Yeah, nice. Okay. Like, so, guys, tune in for that. Thursday, we got Niche Night, Hockey Happy Hour, and Lazy Booking. Friday we still have – no, we don't. And then this weekend, still got Weekly Roundup and Agree to Disagree. And then Monday – of course, Sports Hounds, and then we'll be back on Tuesday. Sorry, go ahead.
And in this very ring with Andy and the boys on Saturday as well.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, yes. Sorry about that. So, yeah, tune in on all our shows that we have every week, guys. Sports are starting to pick up. We got just the announcement of NHL coming back soon. Hopefully the NBA comes back soon, so definitely stay tuned with sports coming back. A lot of conversation is going to be generated, so definitely – definitely join in the conversation with us. Oh, and then yes, Chrome and I, we have our former high school classmate, former WNBA player Charnay Zoe Norman, will be interviewed tomorrow at 2 p.m. Don't miss that. It's going to be a really, really good interview. Charnay is a great, great, great person. It's going to be a lot of fun tomorrow. But thank you guys all for tuning in. Seriously, we love the support. We appreciate you. We hope you guys are all staying safe out there. Today's show was brought to you by our doc, Paul Vidal, of Specialized Physical Therapy, M-Buck Services, Gutter Cleaning, QB54, the best tailgating game in the business, and, of course, PhillyJinkers.com, selling all our A2D apparel and merchandise. Get 25% off the Philadelphia QB Factory shirt. It's a great shirt, guys. It's hilarious. So get it while you have that discount. From myself, the bro, Ryan Brodo, RB Factory over there, Pete Evans, and the guy over all the way in the Maldives, Kevin Godwin, as well as from Tom and Chrome, we wish you guys a good week. Remember, stay safe, and we will see you again next week.
And there's only one way to finish this off.
Yes!